Connecticut's Mill River is just 13 miles long, yet it tells the whole story of humanity's complicated relationship with rivers. These amazing bodies are our sources of water for drinking and farming, our playgrounds and our fishing holes. We write songs and poems about them. We love our rivers, but not nearly enough. We use them as dumping grounds for human and industrial waste. Our road salt, lawn fertilizer, and pesticides screw them up. And unfortunately, when we kill our rivers, we kill ourselves. Arising in the woods in the suburbs, a trickle grows into a stream.
The Mill River is a really special river. It starts in Cheshire in a swamp and flows through a residential area until it meets the Lake Whitney, which is a drinking water supply. And it flows over the dam through East Rock Park, which is a significant park in New Haven and Hamden and an important bird area, and then out through an industrial area in Fairhaven. And that's really what makes this river special, is that combination of recreation and aesthetics mixed with a working waterfront. It really showcases the history and the people of the river, somewhere that people can still come together and love the river.
Well, I love all kinds of waters, oceans, lakes, ponds, rivers, but I do live just a couple of blocks from the Mill River. And so it's my local example. I row on it and I walk along its banks with my dog, and there's a quote, if there's magic on earth, it's contained in water. And I think that applies to the Mill River.
Honestly, the most important thing we can do to save the Mill River and protect the Mill River is be conscious of what we're doing on land and remembering that we're connected to the river. You know, when you're doing yard work, remembering that where the waste goes matters, that fertilizers and pesticides all end up washing into the river.
We're studying road salt because it's a kind of contaminant that's ubiquitous. We find it every place that there's roads, and it causes harm to aquatic organisms. It can be a problem for people because, as you probably know, salt is sodium chloride, and sodium causes a risk of hypertension in a lot of individuals. What you see on the tree there is a camera trap, and it's a device that takes a picture whenever it detects motion. And we're using it to capture whenever a salt truck goes by so that we know how much salt has been applied at this site. It does get into the water supply. The Mill River flows into Lake Whitney, which is indeed a drinking water supply reservoir, so people drink this water.
The Farmington Canal was a commercial waterway that came in through New Haven. It basically was the supply of water to fight the fires in buildings and so forth. But eventually that waterway was drained and turned into another mode of transportation, railroad. If there was going to be a public water system, drinking water was kind of like an afterthought. At that time, there was no water treatment. The water that came out of the source is the water that would use in the household and for drinking purposes. The source of water for the Haven Water Company system originally was the Mill River.
In the early days of European settlement, the mill became a workhorse for industry. Eli Whitney, famous for the cotton gin, manufacturing muskets, and using interchangeable parts, dammed the mill and powered his machines with it.
It's in this moment at the beginning of the 19th century, the end of the 18th century, that water becomes the great laboratory out of which the future is crafted. And it's powering machinery all around the world. What Whitney did was connect to that flow of invention that was already well established in Europe. We get out and play in water at the museum because water is a fundamental force whose work you can actually touch and connect with all of your senses. Water is a very visible force of invention, and it's as direct and articulate a teacher now as it was in the 19th century when water was beginning to be the power that would change the world.
Once the mill enters New Haven, it is transformed again, this time into a graceful ribbon of water ambling through an urban park.
So the park and the river are a bird magnet because of potentially the mountain that's here, because the birds, while they're migrating at night, will be able to see the mountain landmark on it and fly to this natural northern corridor that we have here called the Mill River. This river will provide abundant food resources for them as they make landfall in Connecticut. What's wonderful about warblers are they're butterflies of the avian world. There's up to 24 species that come through East Rock Park, and the males are all colorful. But the warblers are special. Each one of them are quite beautiful and unique as far as their color patterns. Oh, the best day ever probably of warblers is in East Rock Park when you get a fog that comes in while the birds are migrating. This causes the birds to get very low. They can't migrate out of the area. And what occurs is something called a fallout. And at that time, you'll see any number of the same species along with potentially multiple different species. It's fantastic, and it's what every birder around here lives for.
Striped bass, largemouth, carp. Yeah, it's quite a few different species in here.
Do you take them home and eat them?
No. Just for the sport. Yeah. Just for the sport. Especially now that they up the size on the stripers. So it's kind of hard to catch the size that they want.
The Mill River Trail Project is about getting people in New Haven out to experience the nature that we have along the Mill River. It runs from Criscolo Park all the way up to the Eli Whitney Museum. And we're putting together piece by piece, so it's continuous. The Mill River Trail will be a success if people continue to come out and discover nature, if they continue to interact with each other, if people can move more easily using bike or foot between the various places they need to go day to day. In my own experience growing up, interactions with nature made me who I am, and I have a deep sense of connection to the whole world because of that early connection to nature. And it's really important that we bring that to the urban environment so that people of all ages, but particularly young people, can have those formative experiences contacting nature. There's an interesting story about a submarine and the Mill River. John Holland was an early inventor and prototyper who was building one of the very first submarines down in New Jersey. He was funded by some folks who were Irish and supporting the Irish effort against the British. Many of those people were from New Haven, and when there was a financial dispute, the people from New Haven decided that they would bring that submarine back to New Haven. And while trying to figure out how to actually drive the thing, they were declared a nuisance to all navigation by the harbor master of New Haven. Then, having nowhere to take the submarine, they were forced to take it up the Mill River, and they stashed it away hidden in a shed up near where the highway is. It sat there for 40 years, eventually being discovered and recognized for its historical importance, was taken down to New York, displayed at Madison Square Garden, and now sits in a museum in New Jersey.
In New Haven, the mill traces the path of industrial history from Whitney's 18th century factory to the heavy industry of the mid-20th century. Industrial waste was dumped into it, and its banks were tortured into unnatural shapes.
Industry, heavy industry in the late 19th century formed around the Mill River for a fairly specific reason. One, the river, and two, that this area was cheap land, water power, wide open, and quickly filled with tons of cheap labor. And the railroad cut right through. So it was literally a gateway to New England. People may not be aware of this, but this was a center of the cardboard box industry. These boxes serviced the clock industry to ship clocks, etc. And Bayer aspirin, Colgate toothpaste, your pack of cigarettes, were all made at the National Box Folding Company. In these days, there were next to zero regulations in the early 20th century, and by the 1950s and 60s, it was discovered that the Mill River was so polluted that there was discussion at the time just to pave it over.
There's been a power plant here on the banks of the Mill River since at least 1890. Station B, which was just demolished by UI as part of the ongoing remediation here, was built in 1890. In 1929, they built this really architecturally magnificent industrial monolith, English Station. So you can really see English Station as a symbol of New Haven's interwar prosperity. I think you see the land use pattern in New Haven is you have industry next to our waterways, the rivers and the harbor, because that was the primary method of transportation. And that's how they transported initially the coal that was used to fire the power plant. The fate of the Mill River and the fate of English Station are entwined in so many ways. And partly that is because of the legacy of pollution. I mean, this power plant has been spewing and spilling and leaking soot and ash and smoke and particulate matter into the river for more than 100 years. And if you look at the sediments in the river, you'll see layer upon layer of contamination. I could talk about the nightmares that I have about a Category 5 hurricane, something like Hurricane Sandy, with an 18-foot storm surge ripping into New Haven Harbor and destabilizing the bulkhead here on the south end of Ball Island, and this facility, this power plant, sliding into New Haven Harbor. I mean, this is something that I literally have nightmares.
My main concern about air and water pollution in the Fairhaven area is the lack of residents being informed. Most of them are immigrant or Spanish-speaking background. Therefore, there are cultural language differences that can create a disconnect. Also, another irony is that we have a school right next to us. Growing up, I used to feel hopeless on a lot of environmental injustices that happened in New Haven. When I moved back to New Haven after college, where I started joining coalitions, committees, advisory groups, where I started seeing how my individual voice can weigh into the major decisions that are made on a bureaucratic level.
New Haven's Fairhaven neighborhood is sandwiched between the Mill and the Quinnipiac Rivers, so it's nearly surrounded by water. It is a working-class neighborhood that is among the most vibrant in the city, bursting with recent immigrant energy.
Lots of Fish is an organization that uses art to teach environmental education and focusing on water. So the more fish, the better. Lots of fish. I work with kids on a regular basis in schools, and I use art to educate and work with large groups of people to collectively come together to make our world a little better place, whether it's more beautiful or more healthy. The Drain Art program came out of a summer youth employment program where we used art to kind of engage the public in understanding the cycle of our water and the cycle of pollutants that get into our water. The storm water is sometimes combined in the sewer and storm water, and it creates overflows, and which additionally pollutes the water. But then there's also all of the candy wrappers and soda pop and all the different types of containers that make its way, even cigarette butts, that all make their way into the drain and out to the water. The idea of having art as an appealing way to bring an environmental message and teach people is really the basis for it.
Thank you.
The Mill River merges with the Quinnipiac at Grapevine Point, where a city park now borders an industrial zone. There are layers of history here. Native Americans trapped fish in these waters. Black volunteers for the U.S. Army trained here for the Civil War, and Frederick Douglass addressed them. During the 1940s, unions organized workers in the factories. Today, it's a beloved park, where a community of mostly Latinx people enjoys baseball, dominoes, and fishing from the pier. In the 19th century, New Haven was one of the oystering capitals of the country. Workers shucked oysters in the basements of riverside homes. Storms and pollution caused a collapse. Today, New Haven's rivers and harbor are incubators for a rebounding oyster industry.
New Haven is really where the oysters start for us. We start them up in the rivers, and that's where we plant our shell, and that's the start, the nursery. What we do in New Haven Harbor is we grow oysters, and we move it every year from lot to lot. I always try to do a thing I call seasons of oystering. You know, every season there's a different part going on in the oyster industry. So we gather the shell all year, and now we're starting to put it up on the beach up in Quinnipiac. And you'll see a big steel boat be running back and forth, and all that boat does is catch shell. And I'll bring the shell in, we put it up on the beach, and we dry it. Then come July, that's when we get ready to start to put it in the water. Because that's when the oysters are going to spawn. The water temperature gets up to like 70 degrees. And when the spawn shoots out of the oyster, swims around for like a week. And then when it swims back to the bottom is when we want to put the dry shell down. They catch a nice seed bed. And we'll move the oysters around New Haven Harbor for probably a couple years. And then we'll start moving it down to Norwalk. The environment's big. We're big in water quality, paying attention to our rivers that dump into the harbor. What we do is we test five or six rivers. We monitor like all summer. We got a record of what the water quality is. So the minute that jumps up, we notify the state, you know, we'll notify the town and they go and find the problems and fix them. You know, our market grounds are miles away from that. And, you know, so we want to really make sure these inner harbors stay real healthy.
Finally, the mill enters the harbor and mingles with the water of the Long Island Sound.
The Native Americans in this region lived in harmony with the nature, so they respected all aspects of nature, both animate and inanimate objects were seen as sacred to them. And so when it came to places like a river such as here, that had a spirit of its own, which had to be respected and had to be thanked in gratitude for what it would offer them in terms of sustenance. When the English first came to this region, they looked to the Quinnipiac for assistance in terms of how to deal with fishing and collecting clams and oysters and shellfish and hunting. As a matter of fact, probably I would say the first 5 years or so, even the Greater New Haven colony probably depended quite heavily on the native people providing them with meat from hunting and assisting them in fishing.
The Mill River really shows us how we, for a while, moved away from natural resources and our rivers and really saw them as tools to move things and to remove waste. And as civilization has come around to appreciate them as natural things and our need to protect them, it really brings community and people together. You know, linking work that's being done in the headwaters to work that's being done downstream and the people. And bringing them together to protect this precious resource that wasn't always viewed as something to protect, just something to use.
Explore your own river. Learn about its history. Meet people on its banks and talk to them. By learning about our rivers, we can learn more about our place in nature. And just maybe, we can save ourselves.
This is the origin of the Mill River, or one of the areas where it starts.
This is flowing into that pond, and that pond, you consider what goes out of that pond, the Mill River, and I would consider this
the Mill River.
Part of the Mill River.
That's interesting.